Hello everybody, welcome back to my channel where skincare is all about progression over perfection because perfection doesn't exist. Yes, I have a new backdrop. I know people are going to be like, I missed the old one, but it happens every 3 years, you'll be fine. Today I want to talk about something that is kind of like really just like, I think I've said this at the beginning of every video, I've not been feeling great the last week and I'm really just in the mood to complain. And I feel like complaining's good for us sometimes. It's great to be like, oh, happy everything and everything's great. But sometimes it's nice just to have a little moan. This channel was definitely a safe space to complain. I feel like there are certain things within the skincare community, definitely just online, across all apps, where there's unnecessary discourse for no reason. Things where I personally feel like, you know, we've been there, we've talked about this, why are we still discussing this? Why is this still an issue? I'm just like, oh my God, can we move on now, please? I thought we'd done that. I thought we sorted that. Of course, learning something new every day is important. Not everyone learns everything at the same time, right? But these are things that I feel like we've all learned about before, yet we're still kind of being like, well, we don't really need to be. And also a mix of just like comments that kind of annoy me. I'm sorry. Every time I do these videos, I'm like, this is so fucking petty, but let's just get on to it. This is something that I hate talking about because I thought we stopped talking about this, yet it's still something that comes up all the time with every new launch, every kind of product review, and that's fragrance, the fragrance debate, which shouldn't even be a debate anymore. For example, like if someone launches a product, someone's like, with fragrance, yuck, no thank you, I don't need that. Fragrance serves no purpose, the usual, the usual, the usual. Why are we still debating this when we know what the science says? I get at the beginning when it was a first like flagged to all of us, I guess, that fragrance may irritate some people. We're like, oh shit, like I didn't know that. I had no idea about that. And I was using so many things with fragrance in as someone with rosacea, but I've never had an issue with it until I thought I did because I was told I do. We now know every expert's take on fragrance within skincare and cosmetics. But fragrance seems to be one of the only things within the skincare community that people are okay ignoring the science about. A lot of people are very much into their skincare science, you know, creators and viewers, consumers, yet for some reason when it comes to fragrance, we're like, ignore the science, let's err on the side of caution. It's one of the only things that people are like, I'd rather not. Like, why are we ignoring the science here? I don't get it. Like, why is this the one topic that we're like very anti-science about? Because you can potentially develop an allergy to it. So what? So what? You can with most things. And then a lot of people are like, but it doesn't serve a purpose. Well, it does. Aromatherapy and cosmetics is a purpose. Just because it's not your preferred purpose doesn't mean it's not a purpose. Just because it doesn't have benefits directly to the skin, actually some fragrances do play a huge part in formulation, but just because it doesn't have that kind of benefit doesn't mean it's not a benefit or a purpose, you know? And there's some confirmation bias at play here as well, because you've heard a dermatologist, esthetician, whatever, say that fragrance is bad, whilst not delving into the nuances. There's so many different nuances around fragrance within cosmetics. Purely that it's bad, it can cause irritation, if it's not now, later down the line. Very cutthroat, very black and white, when we know nothing within science or skincare is black and white. And this, to me, does verge on the edge of fear-mongering. I think putting something so blasé and saying, oh, it's fragrance, it's gonna cause an irritation, is very fear-mongering to me. And to me, fragrance is slowly, slowly becoming up there with paraben-free. It's verging on the side of clean beauty. It's verging on the no nasties, you know, clickbait EWG style, no fragrance. You know, soon we're gonna start seeing EWG, paraben-free, fragrance-free, because it's verging on that slide where people are ignoring the science behind it so much and just listening to the negatives that we're gonna get there with fragrance one day. It's up there with clean beauty for me. But the issue is that people listen to one side of the argument. Well, it's not an argument because we know what the science is. There's no debate here, there's no argument, but we'll listen to one side of, I guess, expert experience and then roll with that instead of listening to people who create these fragrances, people who actually regulate these fragrant ingredients, people whose job it is to regulate the health and safety, the irritation aspects, you know, all that kind of regulatory stuff that goes behind fragrance. And yes, fragrances are highly regulated. I think it was, who was it? Two great posts over on Instagram by Sam by the Counter and also the Cosmetic Regulator, to, you know, kind of put it into my own words, so sorry if I misquote them in any way, but fragrances are highly regulated. By the International Fragrance Association, the IFRA, they basically set the standards, the criteria for the use of fragrance in cosmetics, and also 2 to 3 years every so often, they'll kind of like revisit this and often ban fragrant components and fragrant ingredients as well. So people aren't just tossing fragrant ingredients into a skincare product and mixing it up and being like, good luck with that, you know. They are regulated. And yes, fragrance, a parfum, whatever you want to call it, can be the brand's secret recipe. We're not always going to know 100% what those fragrant components are. It's different in the US to the EU. There are certain fragrant ingredients that they have to list. But what that doesn't do is exempt them from any kind of like rigorous regulations and toxicity studies. So they're not just putting fragrance in and getting away with it. These things are still held to the same kind of standards. Basically, there's no debate here. Does your skin react to fragrance? If it does, don't use it. If not, which is the majority of us, it's not gonna cause you any kind of irritation, carry on using it. It's not when my skin reacts to it, it's does it react to it or does it not? That's it. That's it. We're not all supposed to be living in fear that one day potentially we might develop, the very small percentage of us might develop this allergy, you know? Of course, there's personal preference, but that's not part of the debate. You know, whether you like fragrance or not is down to you. Whether you're irritated to or not is an important part of the debate. But erring on the side of caution doesn't make sense unless you do that with everything in life that can potentially cause you any kind of damage in any way. I'm so bored of it. And there'll always be people again who say that there's not enough fragrance-free options. It would be nice just to have the option. I agree, but also this isn't a pandemic. It's not that common. There's not like a whole, you know, huge amount of people suffering enough for it to make sense to businesses to spend money on fragrance-free kind of option. And whilst I do think it is important for people to have the option, it just doesn't make business sense too. But there are also a lot of very, very popular, naturally fragrant-free products and brands overall that don't even, you know, class themselves or advertise themselves as being fragrance-free. The Ordinary, the Inculus, CeraVe, just to name a few because they are some of the most popular and readily available. I would say don't waste your time just avoiding things in life just because one day they might damage you or hurt you. There are plenty of things in life that serve no purpose other than to bring us joy, which is a purpose within itself. Skincare, food, drinking, entertainment, that's what life is about. Companies do not make these products and spend millions just to put a product out there that they think is going to irritate the vast majority of people who will then never spend money on their brand ever again. And yes, some people react to fragrance because that's life. Everyone reacts to something. Here's a difficult one, and this is something that I personally struggle with still, really, and that is trying not to be problematic with brands and trying to pick brands that someone doesn't see as problematic, which I have to say, whilst I've been doing my When Beauty Turns Ugly series and researching many different brands that I've not even posted videos about and looking into the history of brands that I've not posted videos about yet, it's next to impossible to not support a brand with your money or use a product from a brand that is not in some way considered problematic to someone somewhere. You have to be in a very privileged position to be able to fine-tune any kind of lifestyle, skincare, cleaning products, whatever, to be so selective about the brands that you spend your money on based on your morals and preferences, because it is impossible. You have to be very privileged to have that much access to that many brands. Does that mean we should all go, oh well, who cares, like, you know, and just use everything and support whoever for anything? Absolutely not. I 100% have my limits on brands. For example, when CEOs have been openly racist, homophobic, any ick or ist, I will not support them. I won't support them because that's my personal preference. I hope it's others' personal preference as well. When there's something that clean cut and clear as day. For example, I cancelled a job with DHC Cleansing Oil, a product that's really popular in the skincare kind of like community, but not a lot of people know that their CEO, who is still their CEO, was very openly racist towards Koreans. That's a problem. That's an issue for me. So I dropped out the sponsorship. I won't use DHC again. Nivea, I don't use because the people who are in charge still and will benefit from me buying their products very openly said to an advertising agency that they don't do gay at their company. Me as a gay man, I personally choose not to use their products. There are brands that you use every day that I can guarantee you can trace back to something problematic, especially as they're, you know, in such a huge conglomerate. Etude House, for example, is one that always shocks people. Broke the law a while back, selling products in Thailand illegally that they shouldn't have. Problematic. Some people might be able to look past it. It's not the biggest thing for me. I'll be like, okay, they broke the law, fine. I will still use an Etude House product, you know? That's my personal preference, I don't mind. Vaseline just itself as the actual main product is a huge, hugely popular in the skincare community right now. Skincare whitening, not lightening, whitening adverts all throughout the world, even to this day. People may have an issue with that. People may not, you know, it's problematic. And of course, there are some cases that are worse than others, but I've had people in my DM slamming influencers and their product launches, you know, and the ways that they were launched, then right under that DM, they're asking me to review Jeffree Star skincare because they love Jeffree Star. To me, that's an issue. To me, I would rather review that influencer brand over Jeffree Star, and I don't think I have to explain why. If you care more about bad-mouthing an influencer than you do racism, then I guess that's your prerogative. But I guess what I'm saying is be consistent, but it's also very hard to. As I said, there are different degrees to what I think is very obviously wrong to what some people might be okay with. And that's what I mean by feel what does right to you. I'm definitely not gonna support a big racist brand or anyone who supports a huge racist brand, for example. But I feel like a lot of people nowadays kind of do look at any kind of issue, slightest issue, and call that brand problematic. Then people get slammed for using that brand. What I would say is do your research into these brands, into the CEOs, into the people behind this brand. I do think it's important to vote with your money, but I'm not gonna judge. If you wanna use something, use it. I do think it's important, however, to still hold brands accountable, and I will call out brands if I think something's wrong and listen to other groups who feel like they've been discriminated against by this brand. But if there's an apology that's mine to accept, and if I accept it, I will have no problem using that brand, for example. It is difficult to balance out, you know, what level or degree are we like, okay, that's fine. That's something I can look past. I think it's tough. And as I said, it's still something I struggle with. I definitely do have my morals and my standards, but yeah, it's a tough one, I think, but also not really. But also kind of. Here's a point that comes up again with every celebrity launch, every influencer launch, every brand launch in general. And this, I'm kind of going to merge two in one. This is that skincare experts should only be trusted as default, and that only dermatologists can launch brand products. I think people with these titles take advantage of the fact that not everyone is clued up as to what that particular title actually means and what their studies consist of and what their experience consists of. We've all seen a shit doctor, right? We've all seen a doctor who sends you home with like 100 paracetamol when really what you need is your appendix removed. And that's kind of how it is throughout all expertise, not just in skincare, but throughout life. You know, you get your good, you get your bad. Doesn't matter how long they've been studying for, what title they have, you get your shit and you get your good. We've seen holistic doctors online, for example, still talking about how bad parabens are for you. This is a dermatologist who should know better. We've seen doctors saying that people with dark skin can't use AHAs and they should use their own products instead. We see estheticians pushing clay masks and making up product claims over on TikTok for a product to go viral, rather than telling the truth behind a product just so that they can push that product, and then you realize that they have an affiliate link with that brand, you know? It's just because someone has a title, it doesn't mean they are to be trusted. One person I always talk about is Michelle from Lab Muffin Beauty Science on this channel. She also does a great job at debunking experts over on TikTok. But also, why do I trust Michelle? She's an expert. Why is she basically one of my default experts to go for? Well, it's because even though I'm not an expert, I know how to do my research. I know how to, you know, follow. So we all do. We all do. Especially if you've been to university or ever had to write a dissertation of any kind, you know how to do research. I mentioned this before, but I used to follow so many experts. And during the years, I've whittled them down to people who I feel don't just lead by their own opinion and their own bias. Can see and point to both sides of the argument, kind of come to their own conclusion, even if it goes against what they truly believe. You know, experts who update their findings, who, you know, correct themselves if they got something wrong or if new evidence has been found. For me, when someone is so black and white about a topic, it's difficult to kind of trust that they're not just leading by their own thoughts and what they think is the right thing to do. You know, it's very tough, but it's a minefield out there. It's kind of like 50-50 in the sense that we are so lucky to live in a time where we have so many experts giving out so much free advice online, but it's also difficult because there is so much free advice online by so many different experts. But it is really, really tough. So what I'm saying there is, like, just because someone has a title at the beginning of their name doesn't mean they can't be called out on their shit. Now that kind of leads me on to only dermatologists should launch skincare lines. And this happens every time I talk about a new launch, is that, you know, well, they're not a dermatologist, I'm not gonna buy their product. They're not a skincare expert, I'm not gonna buy their product. A celebrity, they're not a dermatologist, why should I buy their product? What I think this shows again is kind of our lack of understanding of what particular titles actually mean. And a lot of people, I feel, because they are popular online, I feel that dermatologists are the default of the skincare world and voice. The only voice of authority and reason when it comes to skincare. They're a great voice of authority, but they're one voice of authority in a huge, big team and world. If only dermatologists launched skincare lines, then we wouldn't have skincare lines like Pixie, Glossier, Tan Luxe, Glow Recipe, the newest one, Bioma, The Ordinary. All these brands come from makeup artists, entrepreneurs, even a computer scientist. So even some of the best brands have nothing to do with a dermatologist. In fact, I would go as far to say as most brands are created without a dermatologist involved. What I personally feel is important is the vision, the understanding of the market. Is there anything new to create? And then working with the right people to create that. Do I think everyone should be launching skincare lines here and there just because they should and they could? No, absolutely not. I think there's too much going on. We all know that. But I do think we have to deal with the fact that when there's money to be made, there's gonna be products launching and there's gonna be some really awful launches, but there's also gonna be some very, very good little launches here and there. You know, you have to look at these celebrities, these people, whoever they are, and think, who are you and why are you doing this? Does it make sense? You know, and kind of going back to like, you know, who is this person, back to, you know, people with title being the voice of reason. When it comes to product launches, let's look at who they are. How involved in the industry are they? You know, let's analyze their content. You know, what does this person have to gain from pushing these products or creating this brand? You know, we can do our own research. Unfortunately, the internet isn't like that. And I include myself in this, that the internet makes us very, very lazy. And unfortunately, it's only getting worse with, you know, 15 second TikToks, for, in my opinion, allow for no nuance at all. They are the equivalent of looking at a newspaper headline and not the article itself and just getting all the information you want from the headline. You know, it's kind of like to pull you in and grab your attention without actually giving you all the details and all the information. So we go away with an idea that isn't actually 100% accurate. So it's tough. I feel like I'm including myself in all this, by the way. It's kind of like a minefield right now. It's very difficult to navigate. Sorry, I'm still sick and I'm running out of breath now, so I'm gonna end it there. I hope you enjoy complaining with me today. Let me know if you feel the same about any of this and your opinions down below. You can watch some more product reviews here and some general light entertainment here, and I'll see you over there.